Watch.
Who?
Hello. Hello.
And welcome to... Oh, no. It's To Watch Who. No, what have I done? Hold on. Here we are. Sorry. We will start in a sec. We're backstage at the 1980's All-Stars Award. I'm just rehearsing my lines.
Wrong. Mark, we've been saying this for four
I've
years.
Forgotten. Yeah, but it's been a couple of weeks since we recorded and I can't remember
four
now.
4 years, love.
Anyway, we'll go on stage in a minute. Are you ready? The awards, yes, absolutely. So just to let you know what's going on, I've got the production schedule for today here. We've been building the, getting all the catering ready and everything. Julie's here with her cart. Edith's overseeing it all and everything. So we've got two locations because this is such an epic award show covering the whole of the 1980s. We start at the beginning of the 1980s. We've rented out the Leisure Hive way back there. And then we've also got the Youth Centre as well. So I thought we'd be in a location each. Which one do you want to go to?
I'll go in the Leisure Hive.
You're going to the Leisure Hive?
Yeah.
Okay, and then I'll present over at the Youth Club.
Fine.
With everybody, and then we can both, sort of co-present like that.
Fine.
Yeah, plan?
Glam.
Okay, let's go.
Bannermen and Borats, Tetraps and Pterolaptals, the To Watch Who 1980s Awards are about to begin. Please welcome Mark and Sarah.
Hello.
Hello.
Oh, shit, I forgot my line again.
And welcome to To Watch Who.
That's it. And welcome to To Watch Who, a Doctor Who podcast. I'm Mark.
I'm Sarah.
And I'm a Doctor Who fan.
And I'm new to watching Who.
Watching for the very first time.
Very first time.
And welcome everybody to the 1980s All-Stars Awards.
Hooray!
Yes, yes, welcome.
Here we are.
Welcome everybody for the 1980s. We've got Sarah over in the Leisure Hive.
Yes, me, sorry, yes.
and I'm here at the Youth Centre from Survival. We've decked it out. We've got all the cats. And Sarah, you've got Zero Gravity. You've got all the cool 1980s plastic chair things out for everybody.
The leisurely things that were in the Leisure Hive.
Do you remember the Leisure Hive?
Sort of. I remember there were things that you could sit on, and there was that one room, wasn't there?
Well, there was. Do you remember Mina and Hardon having that? Hardin. You know Mina. She was in yellow. She had green on her face.
Oh yeah, that rings a bell. Yeah, yeah. I remember that it was like someone dying. That's all I remember. Leisure Hive.
Mina, so she's over there, so ask her if you need any help or anything. She's running the Leisure Hive, with the baby.
Yeah, I remember the baby.
Anyway, we are here to celebrate the 1980s, also known as What Can Sarah Remember from the Last Decade?
When Mark said hard on, my eyes went really wide. Just for the And what viewers don't see. What viewers, what listeners don't see. Viewers would see. Listeners do not see.
And also, this must be your favourite episode. You've not had to watch anything. You've not even had to decide anything.
I know. I just turn up. I really do just turn up.
It's all done for you and it's all going to be a surprise.
It's a complete surprise to me. Mark does all the work, all the prep.
Well, it's a surprise to me as well because the initial rounds went out on our social media, on Twitter and Instagram. We got some of the rounds down to the final three. And then the rest of the votes went out to our coffee members. So they have decided, mainly for Lucas, really, the rules and regulations of the All-Stars Award should be explained. So we have all of the votes. In the case of a tie, I've done it wrong because we will fall into that trap of you deciding the winner. So, I will ask Sarah her vote after we've said all the nominations. I will take note of that vote. And then if there is the occurrence of a tie, I can use there as a vote to decide, but I won't let anybody else know if that's happened or not. So we should just get the results. Does that, that sounds right, yeah?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We're not doing the spoilers of me saying and going, Mark going, and now, as we've had previously.
Yes. So, well, I mean, I could say who's here, but it is literally everybody from the 1980s. So everyone, imagine your favourite 1980s story. The cast are sitting there waving at you. Yay!
Too many to name or remember.
Just imagine them all dressed up. If they're from like the early 1980s, they're over at the Leisure Hive. If they're from the later lot, they're down at the Youth Club. Just imagine that, everyone. I've set the scene.
Yeah. I think that's enough.
Okay.
Let's go.
Let's go. So, we start off with a very fun category, which is only for the All-Stars Award.
Couple of the Decade, sponsored by Julie's Dessert Wagon.
Now, I did put out who I thought should be there for Couple of the Decade. And then our social media members? What are they? Followers? That's it?
Yeah.
Our social media followers got it down to three couples. And the nominees for Couple of the Decade, sponsored by Julie's Desert Wagon, are Turlo and Norna from Frontios, Perry and Yukarnos from Mindwarp, and Bambera and Anselin from Battlefield. So, Sarah, what do you think about that?
I don't remember the last one. Can you remember Bambera?
The Brigadier.
Oh, yeah. Okay, fine, yeah.
Brigadier and Good Son.
Yeah. No, you'd said Brigadier. I remembered it.
And you remember Turlo and Norna? We talked about them a lot.
I remember Turlo. I'm trying to remember.
She was the daughter of the guy who was running that planet, and then those earthworm things came underneath and attacked them.
Yes, yeah. And they were together a lot. Yeah, I remember that.
I mean,
now,
technically probably not a couple, but we put them together as a couple and they ended up being voted in. Obviously, Perry and Yukarnos, a very memorable couple from the 1980s.
Go on.
Brian Blessed and Perry, yeah?
Oh, of course. Yes, of course.
Yeah. You just did a face like you didn't know. I mean, obviously, a surprise couple, even to her probably as well, that it all happened. And do you remember anyone else?
No.
I mean, who else? I did put the couple from the pub. I did put Tegan and Mariner. I don't think Tegan had anyone else. I don't think Nyssa did, really. Nyssa wasn't a coupley person. I can't remember who else. But and they're sort of the main ones. Oh, Ace and Mike. Ace and the Russian guy didn't get through.
Shock. I mean, look, it's a lot of 10 years. I think, like, that's fair.
So
who would I vote for in that?
Yeah, who are you going to vote for?
I would vote for Perry and Brian Blessed.
Perry and Yukarnos. Oh, you know what? I saw on YouTube, Brian Blessed was doing a convention recently, and he was doing a talk, and they were asking it. I mean, he talks about Flash Gordon quite a lot, but he was talking about Doctor Who and about how he marrying Perry and everything, except he kept calling her Pearl.
No, don't ruin my, like, vote, Mark.
No, and he was like, and then, you know, when I married Pearl, and Pearl was here, and nobody was correcting him. And then they brought on Nicola Bryant, who plays Perry. And then the guy's like, and please welcome your wife, Perry. And, like, after all this time of him calling her Pearl. I think, but Pearl's a nice name. They should have called him Perry Pearl. Right, okay.
I think it was the right letter.
Yes, yeah, I mean, yeah.
Could have called a Trixie or something.
Right, well, let's find out the winners of Best Couple of the Decade, of the 80s. Yes, sponsored by Julie's Desert Wagon, by the way. Get your watermelons, get your desert fruits, get all of that stuff. She's got a wagon here and at the Leisure Hive as well. She's parked up there somewhere, isn't she? You've got...
Yeah, it's like, you know, when, like, the milkman used to come round, or that guy used to come round with, like, bottles of pop. It's kind of like that idea, but a fruit wagon.
Julie. I can't believe you've renamed her Julie. Oh, dear. Right. The winner of Best Couple of the 80s is Perry and Yukanos.
I need my queen to grace my moment of triumph, Varuni!
Yes, a very clear winner with all of our voters, actually. It did stand out. So people love the whole Perry and Yukanos thing.
I think it's just because out of any of the ones listed, they do end up going off together.
Yeah, it's just funny
like
how...
as a couple.
But it's just funny how it's not really on screen, though, and all of their different endings are all in books and things, and she's had so many different endings. Sometimes
it's said, isn't it? Like, at the end, on it when it's in the trial, isn't it said?
Yeah, but, like, later on, they just show a picture and said, yeah, she's married off and
yeah,
she's
yeah.
happy.
But, like, at least it's said on screen. It's not like a... made-up ending.
No, I suppose it's, I'm just thinking after that, sometimes, you know, like I said, sometimes she escapes him and goes back. Sometimes she does stay with him and have kids, and other times she does other things. Yeah, it's just a funny how it's sort of still open-ended in a way. Like, we didn't see them have that coupleness on actual scenes on TV, that's all I mean. Whereas, I mean, Turlough and Norna didn't either. To be fair, they weren't even written as a couple. They just happened to be in the same story. But
yeah.
Bambera and Anselin did, I suppose. They were actually sort of... Actually, no, they weren't either.
No, none of the ones that have been put as couple of the decade mark would be counted as couples, really.
No, apart from those two.
In the stereotypical sense. But at least the ones that weren't at the end was said to have married and gone together, so...
Sure, yeah.
You know who would have been a good couple of a decade, actually, who I might have had in there, if I was adding to it? What's the name with the green baby and the biker guy?
Oh, yes! Oh, did I include them in the votes? I hope I did. No, I think
hope I...
I'm not sure if I did. Billy and Delta.
Yeah, Delta and Billy.
No, I don't know if I included them. I'm so sorry, everyone.
Because they're like prime, like out of anyone. They actually were a couple.
I put in Joe Bell and Tasman Beat.
No, you put in people that don't count as couples, but the people that actually went off to repopulate an entire...
Anyway, well done, Perry Nikonos. Right, next.
Oh my gosh, that's funny.
Monster of the 80s.
I mean, this was the time when we did merge monster and villain, but for this ceremony, we do have a monster and a villain category. Well, I'll tell you the nominees. We got down to four from everybody else, and they are the Cybermen, the Raston Warrior Robot. I just saw it as your face whenever I say something you have no idea. You were nodding, you were pretending to know what that was.
My phone's out, I'm going to start Googling.
Okay, no, that was the one. That was all-in-one... That's all-in-one bodysuit that that disappeared in the air in the Five Doctors that went, whoop, boo, like that. Whoop, boo. Raston Warrior. Raston Warrior.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, yeah.
And the Vervoids were the plant things. They were made out of plants. Plants, like...
Oh, Mark, don't do that.
That's what they look like.
Like that women's exhibition no, that we had.
That's what they look like. You don't remember the Vervoids.
I'll Google it. Continue.
Okay. And the Candyman.
Oh, yeah, I remember the Candyman. Oh, yeah, I remember the Vervoid now. Yeah. Okay. Interesting. So what was the first one? Cybermen?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, okay. So Cybermen... Wooshy Men, Vervoid, and...
Candyman. Who would you vote for? What do you think?
Candyman.
I mean, the Candyman design was pretty good.
I think that's it. It's such a cool design.
if we're going
really memorable, like out of any, I mean, Cybermen are Cybermen, right? But out of any that you said, as soon as you said Candyman, I was like, I remember the Candyman.
I mean, in terms of the character and what they did, not
they're
great.
Really involved in the story.
Well, I don't. Well, I think the look is more of a look than a character or an actual effective monster. So he's not really. I suppose he could have been a villain. I suppose. I don't know. The Cybermen look cool for the '80s. They had an upgrade and they look very cool.
Yeah, but they're just Cybermen.
The Warrior Robot is just a fun, easy thing. It's just someone in an all-in-one.
Yeah, yeah. It's again cool character, cool thing. Seen it. Ooh, I do remember it now. Yeah, but like, kind of reminds me of like Little Shop of Horrors.
I mean, they're very of the '80s, all of them.
But I think for me, it would be the Candyman.
Okay, let's find out then. Okay, so the winner of Monster of the '80s is the Candyman.
I'm disappointed in you, Doctor. I expected you to choose your friends more carefully.
Hey!
Yes! There we go. Well, we will be serving licorice all sorts at the bars tonight in honour of the candy. He's a robot, it's fine. He's not actually made out of sweets. Well, he sort of is, isn't he? But he was.
How close was it?
Pretty equal throughout.
Oh, okay.
Everybody got a vote at this once. So yeah, well done. Very, very memorable, I think.
I think so.
It's people's favourite story, Happiness Patrol.
Yeah, I think that's it. It's in a good story. As soon as you said it, I was like, oh yeah, I remember that. And it's not because it was recent. It's just a really memorable monster.
Yeah, I think it's really clever design. And it's that time, those last couple of seasons where the designs were just absolutely amazing. I'm sorry that the destroyer, Blue Destroyer, didn't get through.
Kind of like Billy, what's her name, as best couple, but anyway, continue.
Anyway, I totally forgot them. I can't believe I put Mike and Ace instead of Billy and Delta. I'm so sorry, everybody.
I can totally believe that. you put a couple that absolutely not belong together. The people that have gone to repopulate a planet.
But they're all here tonight, so it's fine. And Billy and Delta are going to do a musical set at the end of the night.
Billy and who?
Billy and Delta.
I thought you said Della.
Okay, moving on.
Best villain.
Mm-hmm.
We're down to three. And the nominees are The Master, The Valiard, and Helen A. Very strong contenders there.
Yeah, that's tough.
Tell
you why it's tough. I love the Master.
I knew you were going to say you love the Master. I still can't believe you love the Master so much.
But I didn't enjoy the Master as much in the last one. But I have to remember it's an 80s. It's a decade of the Master.
So we had him in, well, we met him in Keeper of Trark and he took over Nyssa's dad in that one. Then he was in Legopolis.
Which was great. That was such a good reveal.
He was in Legopolis, he killed the Fourth Doctor. Then he was in the next one, Castrovalva. He was in three in a row, we had him.
Yep.
Then he was in that Heathrow Airport one, which wasn't great. Then we next saw him. Oh, he was in the Five Doctors. He was in the King's Demons with Chameleon. And then he was in Planet of Fire, Peri's first one, where she went in Lanzarote. Then he turned up, with the Rani in Olden Times, in the Down the Coal Mines or wherever it was.
Yeah. You see, for me, I think it's the Master.
And then he turned up at the trial. And then he turned up at the youth club. He's everywhere.
I think it's the Master for me. I love the Master.
But the Valiard was cool.
Remind me of the Valiard. Like, I remember the name. I just can't remember the Valiard.
The trial.
But when you
The trial.
Oh, of course. Yeah, the trial. I remembered the name. I just couldn't picture what he was in. He was cool. And we did have him for the four. Was it four episodes?
Well, yeah, he was in, because he's like a proper story arc character.
Yeah, because he's in all of them.
And then
who's the last one? Helen A.
Helen A from Happiness Patrol.
Helen A was great, yeah. Helen A's a great villain.
And again, very, very 80s.
It's tricky.
That is tough.
For me, my vote would be the Master.
Let's see who has won Best Villain of the 80s. And the winner is Helen A.
I told them to be happy.
Hey, I am happy with that. I'm happy with that.
I'm glad you're happy. I don't know. I'm quite surprised, actually. I mean, I just think people love, maybe just our coffee members love Happiness Patrol in the 80s and
well,
that time.
Also, I mean, it's just been it's just screened, hasn't it, at BFI?
Yeah.
So it's all really fresh with people as well. It is a great story, and she's great in it. It's a great villain. You know, we talked a lot about Helen A. In my head, it was between Helen A and the Master. But I do love the Master. So
I think people don't think he's as, because he's in so many stories, I think you forget how good he is sometimes, I think.
But he's in great stories. A lot of the stories he's in, he's great. It's just the last one for me that he wasn't as great. But whenever he's in them, I've always enjoyed him.
I suppose the Valiard is a bit similar to the Master. He's more of a grumpier Master, I suppose.
Yeah, but also, I mean, like, his character only comes out towards the end when it's like, when it turns, you know. Initially, he's just the trial person, isn't he?
Yeah, I mean, he's evil future doctor, which is a big thing. Yeah. I think I like the idea of the Valiard, and they went there and did an arc like that in the 80s.
Yeah, for sure.
But no, Helen A just has that extra showbiz factor, I suppose, that everyone loves. Okay, well, we're getting through them. We're going at a good pace. I hope everybody is... do you know what? We just need to... I knew there was something I was going to say. I knew there was something I was going to say at the beginning. I'm so sorry. And I'm just going to do it now while I remember. Okay, so everyone just take your seats a minute. We do need to dedicate this episode to somebody.
Right.
Who has been a great presence in all of our award ceremonies. Did you see? The guy who played Charlie the Barman passed away.
Oh, I did see. That was a while ago, wasn't it?
It's like 2 days ago.
Was it?
Yeah.
That was a while ago, I'm sorry. No, I didn't see that was 2 days ago. Oh, no, I didn't.
Yeah. So we can't do a ceremony without mentioning Charlie the Barman.
In our in memoriam.
In memoriam. So we just need to take a moment and all raise a glass for Charlie the Barman, who was so brave in the Gunfighters, and you've never forgotten, although I'm not convinced he actually did anything, to be honest. But if you think he did...
Whenever we talk about heroic moments, we always remember Charlie the Barman. We forget other people, but we always remember Charlie the Barman.
Yeah.
Can you remember who was season one or two? Maybe not, but you remember season three is Charlie the Barman. That says a lot.
I wasn't sure if you'd seen it or not, but very recent. So we'll all dedicate this award. Although he didn't appear in any 1980s stories. So, but anyway, let's move on.
Best supporting character.
Now, we did a few rounds on this, and our social media followers got it down to three. So we've had no say in this at all. And the three nominees for Best Supporting Character of the 80s are the Brigadier, Yakarnos, Brian Blessed,
all right, yeah,
and Xiao Yang from Battlefield. I'm not entirely convinced that the Brigadier should represent Best of the 80s. Because he was a 70s character. Okay, he was in The Five Doctors and he was in Mordred Undead. He came back, didn't he? Oh, and Battlefield. Okay, so he's in like three stories of the 80s. So, okay, he is. I've just convinced myself that he should be there. But I don't know. I always think of him because he was with The Third Doctor a lot. He's more of a 70s character. So I don't know about that one. Yakarnos, people love Brian Blessed in that story. Married Perry, he's already a winner tonight. Double award nominee tonight. He stood out. He stood out in that story. He was memorable.
Yeah.
And then Xiao Yang. I love Xiao Yang.
I was going to say, I love Xiao Yang. I think Xiao Yang would be my vote.
She totally represents that supporting character that is with, you know, she was with Ace a lot throughout the story. She knows all the other characters. She got involved in different things. And you know, you instantly, you know her after like the first scene. And she just adds to the story. Like, I thought she was really good fun. So
I agree. I love Xiao Yun. So, I think Xiao Yun would be my vote of those three.
Xiao Yun is going to be your vote. Okay. Ooh, we do have a tie. Still.
Oh.
I didn't think this far ahead on what would happen. What happens if we have a tie still? Do we give it both awards?
I mean, I was going to say, what would your vote have been?
I voted.
You voted.
I don't know. We're looking up. Is Mina over in
the
Legend
High? Maybe we have two winners then. Maybe we just have two winners.
I'm just checking the switchboard. Mina, what do we do? No. No one. I'm just checking with Mina at the Leisure Hive. She might.
We just have two winners, Mark.
Double winners. Are we ready for our first double winner?
I think that's what we have to do.
Oh, dear. Okay. We're all looking around.
I think you have to have double winners. Think you have to double winner it. Double it's a tie, Stephanie.
Okay. Lucas, make a note. Double winners. First time ever. History is being made again. I feel like we make history every time we do an award ceremony. Right. The double award winners. Or maybe we can get people to vote for next time and then next... Anyway, no. Okay.
No. What are you on about, Mark?
Okay.
No.
Okay. Sorry. The double award winners for best supporting characters of the 1980s go to the Brigadier and Xiao Yun.
Oi!
I just can't let you out of my sight, can I, Doctor?
Hey, there we go.
And they make a team. They know each other. They're in the same story. Did they meet? Did they talk to each other? Maybe, maybe not. But no, I think... I mean, everyone just loves a Brigadier. I think that's just why they voted for him. I'm not always his biggest fan, but...
I do enjoy him in the 80s. Xiao Yun, I preferred.
Yeah.
That's okay. That's fine. It's a tie of an eye. I think that's what we just have to do in that instance.
Well done, everybody. Well done. And I have to say, Billy was up for Best Supporting Character.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, he was there.
You was there for that, just not the couple.
No, because the couples are the ones I made up. All of these other nominees are all of our previous winners from each Doscas. That's how it was done, by the way.
Right. But we must put them as a couple.
No, we don't do the couples normally, do we? Oh. So that's why I made the... But, like, supporting characters and stuff, like the Brigadier won season 20, that's why he's there. And, you know, they've all won their own categories in the past. Next.
I'm just letting Lucas know that there's already gonna be
best regular.
Our followers got it down to three, and they are the Fifth Doctor, the Sixth Doctor, and the Seventh Doctor. So none of our companions made it through.
No, we're all out of a doctor.
I mean, because Ace won.
So I can't think of them in numbers. So, like, which is which?
Well, in the order.
Who's the fifth? Who's the sixth? Who's the seventh?
Okay, so Peter Davidson.
Fifth is Davidson.
Yeah.
Sixth is...
Colin Baker.
And seventh is...
Sylvester McCoy. Okay, who would you vote for?
Peter Davidson.
Oh, how come?
I enjoyed his stories. Yeah, I enjoyed him as a doctor. I enjoyed that time. I do enjoy some of the later stories as well, don't get me wrong. But there were also times with that doctor in particular where I didn't enjoy the notch. Whereas, I don't know, there was something just quite fun and traditional about Peter Davidson's doctor.
So if you chose a story from the 80s to go back to, it might be a Fifth Doctor one then?
Potentially, yeah. Or maybe just, maybe not the story, but if we're talking of the Doctor.
So it's sort of different. You can sort of differentiate story and Doctor if you're like, oh, I feel
yeah,
like watching.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Okay. I mean, he did win, I think he won a couple of seasons of Best Regular, like every time.
He did. He was really good as a Doctor. We really enjoyed him. Well, I really enjoyed him.
Yeah, I mean, I really love Colin Baker, the Sixth Doctor. I mean, he had a bad time of it on the show and he was very, you know, strangling Perry, all of that kind of stuff. But as an actor, I think he's the strongest out of those three. I think it's Colin Baker. Mm. Sylvester McCoy started off silly, got much more serious as he went along, but he had those silly moments that it was a bit too clowny sometimes for me. He went from like extreme clown to extreme dark, shouty. And I don't know. I just feel like Colin Baker was the strongest, even though he didn't have the best scripts and the best. He wasn't looked after the best. I think Peter Davison is just fine and he just sort of breezed through it. And he didn't have amazingly strong moments, though. He didn't have a big speech moment or a big anger moment that the other two had.
I think that's more the stories than the Doctor.
Yeah, I suppose so. It was sort of maybe written as it went on. It sort of was written a little bit differently, wasn't it?
It was a fun Doctor. He was a bit younger than what we'd approved of, so there was kind of like a nice energy to that. Whenever I think of that Doctor, I think of that two-episode story in the house with Nyssa.
Oh, Black Orchid.
Yeah. Like, I don't know. I don't know why I always think of that one. And he's dressed up as a clown. And a lot of, you know. And, like, there's some good stories in that time. But he's solid throughout. So he'd be my vote.
Okay. Well, we have a winner. And the winner of Best Regular for the 1980s is, with, you know, most of the votes, the Seventh Doctor.
Every great decision creates ripples. Like a huge boulder dropped in a lake. The ripples merge, rebound off the banks in unforeseeable ways. The heavier the decision, the larger the waves.
Oh!
I mean, again,
I
think...
That's Sylvester McCoy, is it?
That is Sylvester McCoy.
Gosh, there we go.
Which I'm surprised that in terms of, I don't know, it just depends, I think. I think it depends on the demographic of our voters, to be honest. It depends. If you grew up with that Doctor.
The thing is, they are, the Seventh Doctor stories are good stories. We've said that as we're going through, and I think it's really easy to sort of see, you get, and they're good performances. He just do good performances. It's not a diss. He would have been my second choice.
I mean, they're all great. They are all great. It just depends of the type of era as well. I mean, we're talking about the 1980s, but the feel of the Fifth Doctor's first season and the Seventh Doctor's last season couldn't...
They're completely different.
In that whole 10 years, to see the complete difference in just 10 years is, yeah, you are voting for completely different things. So it's a tough one. Okay, well, I hope everybody is having a nice time here at the moment. How's the leisure hive going?
Leisurely.
Yeah. Having a great time there.
Best story of the 80s.
Flying through.
We are, yeah. Oh, just looking. The gym session's coming, trying to come in, but we've booked this for a night, another half an hour, so they can't come in yet.
Mel, take your leggings off, love.
Right, best story. So it's down to three, and the nominees are The Five Doctors, Revelation of the Daleks, and the Happiness Patrol.
Remind me of Revelation of the Daleks.
I knew you were going to say that. That's the Sixth Doctor one with the DJ.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I know exactly which word to say. I just have to make you remember which story it is. I just have to go back and what was the main thing we talked about in that story? That will remind you.
The DJ.
What was the one thing you enjoyed in that story? That's all I've got to say.
Interesting that the three Doctors are 70s. Yeah. And with five. Yeah. Okay. Cool. I'm not surprised by those three stories being there.
Get Happiness Patrol.
People love it.
It's up for three awards now. Five Doctors. Everyone loves the Five Doctors. It's got the Five Doctors in it.
It is what it says on the tin.
Yeah. Revelation, people love Revelation because of its sort of dark humour. It's got all those characters, the Davros in there, Joe Bell and Tazen Beaker, you know, Sixth Doctor and Perry, it's all on location with the snow and the mutant. It's, yeah, you really liked it. We really liked that one. That was fun.
Yeah, it was a good one. It was a good one.
And then Happiness Patrol. I mean, I've come around to Happiness Patrol. When we were doing the episode, I was like, I don't like that one. It's still not my 100% favourite, but I appreciate it after we talked about it. What one would you vote for, though?
For the 80s. It's to sum up the 80s.
We've got the First Doctor here tonight, serving pineapple, by the way.
I'm going to go with The Five Doctors.
Ooh, yeah.
just because it's the fact, am I?
Well, it gets a point because Polly wasn't in it.
Yeah, that's true. I am going to stick with the Five Doctors. I think because it's a 25th anniversary episode, isn't it? It's got obviously the Five Doctors as the idea, you know. I know it doesn't have them all, but like, you know.
Yeah, it's actually got three. But
yeah. That's why I was like, do I? But actually, it is still a good story. We get the Master. Like, it's a fun, enjoyable moment, I think. So it was between that or the I do enjoy the Happiness Patrol. I think it's a really solid story. But I'm going to go with the Five Doctors.
Okay. Just talking about the Master again, I know what you'd love. There's an audio box set, right?
My face literally drops.
Called Masterful, and it's all of the Masters together.
Right.
Like every single one.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, if you love the Master, it's got them all.
Got them all.
Yeah.
Right. Lovely. Mark knows what he's buying me for Christmas now.
I think it's got Chameleon in it as well, and it's got, everyone. Anyway, right. Best story. So the winner of best story. Sorry, you voted Five Doctors, yeah? Okay. The winner of best story is the Happiness Patrol.
I'm not surprised.
Of course. Who is voting all of the Happiness Patrol stuff? Come on. There are certain fans here that just love that time.
Yeah. I nearly did say Happiness Patrol, the reason I didn't is I also enjoyed Revelation, whereas the Five Doctors just felt like a different moment.
I mean, when I see the special edition of Happiness Patrol, I'm probably going to love it, so maybe that's what it is.
Worst moment of the 80s.
Worst moment, your favourite category.
Yeah. Well, our favourite category. You enjoy your worst moment too.
So all the different nominations went up for our coffee members here, so there's more to choose from. So these are all of our worst moments.
10 years of worst moments.
10 years of worst moments are, see which ones you remember. Cassia's eyes in The Keeper of Traken. All the arguing in the TARDIS in season 19. Sarah Jane falling down the really bad cliff thing in The Five Doctors. The Sixth Doctor's first line in Caves of Androzani. Perry being turned into a bird and Sarah missing that moment because of her Uber Eats thing. All the courtroom interruptions in Trial of a Time Lord. The Americans in Delta and the Bannermen. All the loose plots in season 24. And then Ace jumping into the lake in The Curse of Peladon.
Oh my God. It's got to be Perry being turned into a bird. It's got to be for me. That is so funny. Oh my gosh, that's funny.
That's what it says on the official page.
Oh my God, that gets my vote. That's so funny.
I mean, because a lot of them come from you, the worst moments.
But I remember missing, I remember that conversation as you said it. Sorry, that's funny.
All of your ordeal. It's so funny listening back to old episodes because I had the whole story of you and your getting your bed and getting the wrong thing and everything. I was listening to that earlier from way back. All the various things that have happened.
Oh my God.
But no, we have that whole story on our Vengeance of Boros episode, everyone, if you want to go back and remind yourself of Sarah's ordeal with her takeaway.
I was initially thinking, oh yeah, the cliff one, and then as soon as I heard Perry being turned into a bird, I still have absolutely no recollection of it. Yeah, it's that. For me, that gets my vote.
Okay.
We don't even need to go into them anymore. That one gets my vote.
Okay. Well, we have a draw.
Absolutely no recollection of it, and it's hilarious.
We do have a draw.
Oh.
So, are we doing a double award again?
Oh, I'll choose something else. I mean, I'm going to give a special commendation to The Perry Bean Danger Bug that made me laugh. Remind me, oh my God, I would say them all again, but okay, my other vote then was for Sarah and the Clay.
I mean, you hated Ace jumping into the lake.
I really hated that. But I think the cliff was just really shit. Do you remember? Like, it's the tent. It was a five doctors. It was so shit. That annoyed me more. I thought, it's so bad. So I'm going with that.
So we have a winner. And the winner of worst moment of the 80s is the Americans in Doubt and the Bannerman. I'm so glad people agree with me.
There we go.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Those Americans who are here tonight, they're most welcome, but we just don't want you in that story. Did not bring anything to that story. And it was a fun story, apart from them.
I'm glad that someone else possibly, potentially agreed that me makes because that was... But, like, I mean, I just voted for that because I find it really funny. Rather than it being the worst moment. So if I'm being honest, actually...
Well, it can't be worst moment. You don't remember her being turned into a bird, so...
It's so funny. I've still not seen anything of it. It's so funny because I can't even picture it in my head.
Oh my dear. God. Right. Well, now on to another category where... We have all of the nominations up for the whole 10 years.
The Clothes Watch Icon Award.
And so don't worry, everyone. We haven't got the catwalk. We are just going to read out the things.
I can't do a 10-year catwalk.
Although if it was, it would be in your zero gravity leisure hive thing.
Okay. But still, I can't think of comments for 10 years. I struggle when we have to do three.
We haven't got enough room here at the youth club. So,
I'd have to be at the leisure hive.
The coffee's going great here, though, everyone. So, the nominees for Clothes Watch Icon Award of the 80s is.
Are.
Nissa's fairy costume from The Keeper of Traken. Anne and Nissa's butterfly costumes from Black Orchid. Tegan's white boob tube and shorts from season 20. Turlough's short shorts from Planet of Fire. The DJ's multiple outfits from Revelation of the Daleks. Professor Lasky's mauve gym sweats from Terror of the Verfoys. The Rani in Mel's pink and white ensemble. From Time of the Rani, the Happiness Patrol's uniforms from the Happiness Patrol, and Ace and Gwendolyn in their tuxes from Ghostlight. I mean, what a wardrobe we have there. That is very 80s, all of it.
I'm between Turlough short shorts or the fairy outfit.
Nissa's outfit.
Yes, there's Nissa and what's her name's fairy outfit, Anne's.
Okay. Anne? Oh, the butterfly, do you mean?
The butterfly outfit.
Yeah, you're in for their butterfly outfits, yeah, because you like that story. Okay, which one are you going to vote for?
I think I'm going to vote for short shorts. I feel that sums up the 80s really well.
Okay. Well, the winner of the Clothes Watch Icon Award 1980s is... The Rani in Mel's pink and white ensemble.
I did consider the Rani as well. When she turns around and looks like that, it's such an iconic look.
That was memorable for us as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, I did laugh at that.
I mean, it's all McCoy fans voting here, I swear. It's all McCoys. That's what it is. You're all McCoy fans, everybody, aren't you? Oh, dear. Oh, yeah, we've got a fair spread. Across all of the votes. I mean, that definitely sums up the 80s, that outfit. The outfit and the intention of the outfit of Kate O'Mara dressing up as Bonnie Langford.
The wig as well.
Yeah.
And the over the topness of it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we're on to our final round.
The Sir Ian Chesterton Bravery of the Decade Award.
Yep, just to say, Yes, yeah, and thank you so much, Edith, for overseeing all of the facilities here and helping Julie with her stall and the horse and cart and everything. It's not easy to get the horse and cart across Perivale and into outer space. So thank you so much, Edith. Edith is still around, obviously. We didn't really have any... I suppose Desert Julie is the Edith of our 80s. We talked about Desert Julie a lot. She came in late in the 80s, but she stayed.
She's staying.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, and the Honeyman as well, actually.
The Honeyman, yeah. The Honeyman's here at the Leisure Hive.
Yeah, they... I mean, yeah.
That part's funny.
Need some honey, don't they? They're who we're taking away from the 80s, aren't they? We'll remember them. Right, I'll just get on with it. Fine. Okay, so it's the Sir Ian Chesterton Bravery of the Decade Award.
Ugh. Big one.
The big one. And everybody who's won a Hero Award in the 80s is up for nomination. So this will remind you all of those brave people of the 1980s. And they are... Varsh, Adric's brother, sacrificing himself to save people on the Starliner. Adric sacrificing himself. No need to say any more. Nyssa remaining on Terminus to help in Terminus. The Doctor sacrificing himself to save Perry in the Caves of Androzani. Herbert going with the Doctor in Time Lash. Merdine for helping everyone in the underground in Mysterious Planet. Pex sacrificing himself for Paradise Towers to save everyone. Ace attacking the Dalek with a baseball bat in remembrance of the Dalek. And of course Ace again for her personal growth in season 26. I mean, it's funny how there's so many people sacrificing themselves
in the early part, and then by the end it's just some personal growth, isn't it? Herbert, I'd forgotten about. I loved Herbert.
Yeah, we don't talk about him enough, do we?
We do not, but Herbert was great. I enjoyed Pex as well, sacrificing himself. That was a nice moment because that was when people like turned around and were like, watch, he's not that bad. I think for me, though, my vote would go to Adric.
Adric?
Yeah.
I mean, he did try.
It's a really big moment. I know it's really early on in the 80s, but actually the impact of the loss of a companion.
Hold on a second. We have had the impact of a loss of a companion before.
No, in fact, twice. Mark, we are not having this discussion. I cannot talk about the button anymore.
Katarina.
That was in the 60s or 70s or whatever she was. We are in the 80s.
I'm just saying, it wasn't a fresh idea in the 80s. Katarina and Sarah Kingdom, both.
I think in his book, you'll find it was a fresh idea. Even he says so.
I can't believe you remember that. Have you been listening to the episodes back?
I just remember random things. You get a long-term memory after a while.
Okay, so you're voting for Adric.
I'm voting for Adric.
Okay, well, I just want to say thank you to all of our heroes
throughout the season. Yeah, all heroes in our eyes. I could be your hero, baby.
There we go. And there can only be one winner. And we have a winner. And the winner of the Sir Ian Chesterton Heroic Moment of Award of the Decade goes to, Bravery of the Decade Award, I meant to say, goes to the Fifth Doctor for sacrificing himself to save Perry.
Not a very persuasive argument, actually, Stubbs, because I'm going to die soon anyway. Unless, of course,
I give it to a kind of flee.
Unless, of course, I can find the antidote. I owe it to my friend to try because I got her into this. So you see, I'm not going to let you stop me now.
Oh, I mean, I do remember that moment as well, but yeah.
I mean, it goes down because he regenerated from it. You know, it was, he had to do what he had to do. And I think because he'd only just met Perry as well, it was like a, you know what I mean? He had to look after her and...
Gotta do what you gotta do.
He just had to do it, yeah. He had to do it. So, well done, Fifth Doctor. Your favourite Doctor of the 80s.
Yeah, my favourite Doctor of the 80s.
There we are. Yeah. So, well done, everybody. All of those winners.
You're all winners in our eyes.
You are all winners. Absolutely. There we go. And that rounds up the 1980s.
We start new stuff now, don't we?
And then now we're going into the 90s, which is going to be interesting because we're both born then. Yeah. Oh, no, I was born in the 80s. I mean, you're born and I know Doctor Who. That's what I mean.
I'm born.
You're born. So that's, we'll look forward to that. Look forward to the 90s. But no, that rounds off the 80s, yeah. So, and we remember quite a lot, actually. So that's quite good. What a decade. What a decade.
What a decade.
Three Doctors.
Yeah, I can't believe we've got through it. I can't believe I've got through it. I also, like, I still have moments where I'm like, I can't believe we've done classic. But also, I think it's because I know I've got the 90s to do now. Like, it doesn't feel like it's done yet because we haven't started new stuff. So.
No. Well, we'll sort of talk about. I'll just let everyone know the sort of plan for the 90s. So, we're going to do.
Oh, actually, you have to do my thing first, don't you?
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
I sent you my list the other day, didn't I?
Yeah, I'm going to watch some episodes of Bob's Burgers. Yeah. We need to work out how we're doing that, what we're doing for that. Okay.
We'll just release little mini-sodes of it.
We'll work that out. But let everyone know about what's happening for the 90s and yourself as well. Because I think
I'll talk about Bob's Burgers and you talk about what's happening in between.
Because it's a big part of the Doctor Who story that it wasn't on in the 90s. So I think we should cover some of it. But obviously there's so much because it wasn't on TV. But we're going to do. I've got some rules for it, at least. So we're going to go in order, so you can see of like when things came out. So each episode will be roughly, you know, a year or so in the 90s. So we're going to speed up through the years quite quickly through the 90s. And we're going to do the spin-off, sort of straight-to-video things that were keeping fandom alive and the actors going when there wasn't anything, you know, when they were out of jobs. But we're only going to do the ones where it's a character, it's the actor being the character from the TV series, is in terms of the spin-offs, because there was a lot of other ones they did before, right? Whereas let's get all the actors from Doctor Who and they play different parts and they do different things. I'm only doing it when there's it's actually a character or something from the official, in terms of what they would do was they would get license for like one character and then do a story about, you know, like a, you know, like Sarah Jane's got her own series or whatever. They would get a character and the rights to that character, so it would be officially that character, but everything else, you know, they weren't allowed to do actual Doctor Who. So I'm not going to do the ones where nobody's playing any of their same parts. Some of them are like that, it's a bit of a mix, but you'll see when we start going through them, you'll get it. You'll get it. But we are starting off with a super easy one. Super easy. You're going to absolutely love it. I don't know if this is 100% sort of canon or not. I don't think it is, but it's we have to do it. And we head straight to 1993. So we left Survival 1989, nothing until 1993. So we are doing Dimensions in Time, which was the Children in Need special for that year, celebrating 30 years of Doctor Who, and it's 2 10-minute episodes.
Oh, I can do that.
I knew you'd love that.
I can do that.
I knew you would love it.
Please.
So super easy, and it's on YouTube. Easy, right. Easy start.
Excellent.
There we go. And everyone else, because it's on YouTube, all of our listeners can watch it as well if you haven't seen it, which I'm sure you have because it's very, very popular. So we'll go into that next time. Dimensions in Time, everyone, give it a watch on YouTube, and we'll talk about it. So
And I will be getting Mark to watch Bob's Burgers because it's really hard. We did talk about it. The thing is, because people said like, oh, Mark has to watch something that Sarah likes. Well, generally, if I tell Mark to watch something, he does watch it. Pretty much everything I tell Mark to watch, Mark watched all of Gilmore Girls. So like, there's not a lot that Mark hasn't watched that I love. But Bob's Burgers is probably one of the only things.
And yeah, I'm not sure because it's the kind of thing that I would not choose
exactly
to watch.
And I'd never recommend it because like you would never watch it, but I love Bob's Burgers. It's very wholesome and silly, but wholesome. You'll get it. So I've sent Mark. I've tried to think of ones as well. The good thing with Bob's Burgers is the family's great, but also it's kind of like Gilmore Girls, right, in that the side characters make the story in the world as well. So I've tried to find stories, but also not too many that, because you're watching them in absolutely no order. And there's 14 seasons and I think 5 episodes.
Well, I have no idea about it at all. So I'm just going to go straight into it not knowing anything.
I put this in a Bob's Burgers fan group that I'm in.
Oh my God.
See what people, I was like, this is what I'm thinking. And I got ideas from that as well.
Wow.
Cool.
Okay. Well, that's what we've got. We've got plans. And it is only fair because you're going to watch some awful stuff in the 90s. So
you're going to watch some lovely stuff.
Yeah,
I think you're going to laugh at this. I think you will. I think you'll weirdly like it.
I hope
it.
I do like it.
Also, mine's like 20 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. I hope I do. We shall see. Okay, well, we shall see you all very soon, everyone. Get home safe from the Leisure Hive and the Youth Club. Julie's got her wagon. We've got the Eternals, we've got their ship. We've got plenty of transport for everybody. And we will see you all very soon for the beginning of the 90s. See you then. Bye.
To watch who?